welcome to Carbon Engineering. My name is Lori. Thanks for your interest in direct air capture. We hear a lot these days about climate change and net zero, but it's not very clear what we need to do. Are we getting close to net zero? Are we far? Can we even get there? Over the next 10 minutes or so, we'll go on a journey and take a peek at climate change and potential solutions. We'll look at what net zero really means, and we'll even talk about climate restoration, achieving not just net zero, but drawing down some of that excess CO2 in the atmosphere. It will all be based on carbon and climate math. And at the end, hopefully you'll be as excited as we are to be rolling up your sleeves and getting started. First of all, the carbon math. Our carbon cycle is out of balance. In the pre-industrial era, carbon flowed naturally between the air, land, and oceans in a carbon cycle, keeping the Earth's climate relatively stable. In the industrial era, we discovered hydrocarbons underground, which are a fantastic source of inexpensive, instant energy. The problem is that we produce massive amounts of carbon dioxide through combustion of those fossil fuels, and all those CO2 molecules are building up in our atmosphere. We currently emit about 4.5 million tons of CO2 into the atmosphere every hour, and a ton is the weight of a small car. The excess CO2 in our atmosphere is now causing rapid and dangerous changes to our climate. We often hear about a climate emergency or that time is running out. But what does that really mean? There's something called a carbon budget that simply tracks the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere and the remaining room before we hit various thresholds. Here is an example of a carbon clock, showing the remaining carbon budget before we cross the threshold of 1.5 degrees of average warming. When you do the math about the remaining budget to hit 1.5 degrees and our current emissions, you'll see that it means that we have fewer than 7.5 years left. When we look at it through the lens of CO2 concentration in the atmosphere, we're simply talking about parts per million. In the pre-industrial era, we were at about 280 parts per million. Through the combustion of fossil fuels, we added enough CO2 to bring us up to a level of about 419 parts per million today. At 430 parts per million, that's when we hit the average of 1.5 degrees of warming. We're adding about 2 parts per million each year, which is why we only have a few years left. To get back to a safe level of atmospheric CO2, 350 parts per million, we would need to remove about 1 trillion tons of legacy CO2. We're definitely in trouble. Is it possible to solve climate change? What tools do we have in the toolbox to address this problem? Some smart folks have already analyzed the potential climate solutions for us. This slide shows a standard abatement chart, this one by Goldman Sachs, but similar to those done by McKinsey and others. On the y-axis of the abatement charts, we see the cost per ton of fossil emission reduction. What could we avoid through changes such as clean power generation and electric vehicles? On the x-axis, we see the potential volume of each solution, like wind and solar build-out in orange, electric vehicles and low-carbon fuels in dark blue, changes to agricultural practices in green. There's only one thing that doesn't appear on this curve, and that's direct air capture. I'll explain why in a few minutes. After you do all the math for what it will take to get to net zero, it becomes clear that there are three fundamental problems. First, the cost of carbon abatement rises to over $1,000 per ton in many sectors. And the area under the curve, the cost to get to net zero, is over $7 trillion, or 8% of global GDP. Second, we're not yet stopping at the roughly 50 billion tons of emissions per year. Global emissions continue to rise. And third, none of this net zero discussion addresses the roughly 1 trillion tons of excess CO2 in our atmosphere that's already causing climate change and is 95% of the problem. The net zero challenge is immense. Wouldn't it be great if we were able to remove some of the excess CO2 from the atmosphere at an affordable price? Well, the good news is that Carbon Engineering has been working on exactly that problem since 2009. let's take a look at where Carbon Engineering is at with the technological solutions to that carbon removal problem.
Carbon Engineering is a leading developer of direct air capture technology that captures carbon dioxide directly out of the atmosphere. Carbon Engineering has been working on direct air capture since 2009. We first captured carbon dioxide from the air at our pilot facility in British Columbia in 2015 and first produced clean fuel in 2017. CE is now focused on the global commercialization of our direct air capture technology, and with our network of partners, are working to deploy large-scale facilities in many markets around the world. CE's business model is to license our technology to partners to enable rapid and widespread deployment of direct air capture technology. Facilities that use CE's technology can be built in one or more modules capable of capturing 500,000 tons of carbon dioxide annually. In the US, we're working with 1.5 to deploy the first large-scale facility to use CE's direct air capture technology. This facility is expected to be capable of extracting 1 million tons of carbon dioxide annually when complete. We're also working with industry-leading partners on large-scale facilities in Norway, the UK, and here at home in Canada. At CE, we are committed to scaling our technologies to make a significant impact in global decarbonization and helping to address the climate challenge.
The progress that we've made is really exciting. What you see here on the screen is a rendering of the first commercial plant to use our technology in the Permian Basin. We're now over 185,000 hours into the design of that plant, and it's being deployed in the US by our partner, 1.5. We see DAC as the technological missing piece. First, it addresses the cost problem, as it's cheaper than alternatives for many hard-to-abate emissions. Second, it addresses the growth in global emissions, as DAC has the potential to be almost infinitely scalable. And third, it addresses emissions from the past as well as those today. Carbon Engineering's DAC is based on proven technologies, and we're now deploying at commercial scale. With that DAC technology, Carbon Engineering brings the ability to do permanent carbon removal, where we capture the CO2 from the atmosphere and put it permanently back underground into geologic reservoirs. We've also implemented the process to turn that atmospheric carbon into low carbon fuels, a process we call air to fuels. In that case, we simply recycle or reuse the carbon in the atmosphere, and it's going to go through combustion again, and that CO2 will be re-released. But it helps with the carbon balance as we avoid the need to pull more fossil fuel out of the ground for transportation. Carbon Engineering is the only DAC company to have published an open, detailed techno-economic analysis of our solution. We published it back in 2018, so I won't go into detail here, but some of our new innovation was to use some clever chemistry along with use of some off-the-shelf equipment already deployed at industrial scale in other sectors. I will point out the freedom of location, as it's one of the strengths of DAC. We're able to deploy projects anywhere with access to air, water, and renewable energy, meaning that plants can be built in locations with good wind and solar resources and near geologic reservoirs or near fuel markets, avoiding the need for costly CO2 pipelines. Okay, we can capture climate-relevant amounts of atmospheric CO2 at low cost. How much CO2 do we need to capture? Experts estimate that we might need to remove 10 to 20 billion tons per year by the time we get to 2050. So we're looking for storage and utilization solutions at climate-relevant scale. McKinsey has looked at the technical potential for carbon utilization and storage. What do we do with all of that CO2? Turns out that both CO2 storage in the geosphere and the conversion to low carbon fuels are big enough to be meaningful at that climate relevant scale and are already recognized in today's compliance markets. Voluntary markets are also rewarding the durable storage of CO2, such as putting CO2 into concrete. We know what to do with the atmospheric CO2. What does it mean to turn atmospheric CO2 into fuel? Well, fuels like diesel and jet fuel are simply long-chain hydrocarbons. Mother Nature created those hydrocarbons underground over the span of millennia, but we can recreate those fuels in a matter of hours if we have the carbon and the hydrogen building blocks. When we take atmospheric carbon and combine it with clean hydrogen, we produce drop-in compatible fuels. When we make the fuel carbon neutral, we make the vehicles carbon neutral. Even better, those fuels have co-benefits like air quality improvements as they're clean burning. Here you can see our fuel burning alongside traditional diesel fuel, which is yellow and sooty. Our fuel is clean burning because we don't have sulfur or those aromatic hydrocarbons or particulate matter. These fuels have no conflict with food production or other land use, as these projects can be built on non-arable land. And our fuels use about 100 times less land and about 200 times less water than fuels based on biological sources. Okay, so what does it look like when we finally overlay direct air capture on the abatement curve? Well, early commercial DAC projects are estimated to cost about $300 a ton, which is a low-cost solution for about 10 gigatons per year. Over time, costs will come down as they do for all new industrial solutions. At $100 per ton, which is Carbon Engineering's long-term goal, the area under the curve, the cost to get to net zero, could drop from that previous cost of 8% of GDP to under 4% of GDP. DAC has a potential cost advantage of trillions of dollars per year over alternative solutions to achieve net zero. The world has scarce resources to solve climate change, and we believe that DAC will be a very meaningful and affordable new tool in the climate toolbox. Is it feasible to solve climate change, to avoid the worst impacts, and to give future generations back an Earth with a safe amount of CO2 in the atmosphere? At Carbon Engineering, we believe the answer is yes. But we all need to invest in scalable, affordable solutions, and we need to go much faster. What does 4% of global GDP entail? Well, this is a staggering sum of money. But for reference, the US spends about 1.6% of its GDP on coffee, and we spend about 3% of GDP on Christmas Day. What this means is that solving climate change is within reach, and solving climate change is now just a choice. What are our next steps? Well, we're excited that our commercial deployment brings additional options to folks who want to take climate action. If you're interested in participating in projects in your jurisdiction, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. If you're interested in sourcing permanent carbon removal or low carbon fuels, we'd be delighted to introduce you to our global network of partners as they bring those solutions to market. That's it, lots of work to do, but we know what we need to do. If you're interested in direct air capture, please don't hesitate to reach out, and we look forward to tackling climate change together. Thank you for your time.